Well, good evening, everybody, and thanks for coming out to our Sunday night lecture tonight. We have a very interesting subject to consider tonight, which is how the Bible came to us, and our brother Peter Pullman will be speaking to that subject. I'd also like to thank those of our number who participated in that lovely musical item. It's really nice to be able to have that sort of thing back in our hall after such a long period of not being able to. So hopefully we'll be able to see some more of that in the future, God willing. We'll commence our evening together then with a word of prayer, if you would all stand, please. Great and almighty God in heaven, we come before you thankful for this precious time we have to come into this place tonight. We thank you for this opportunity to consider such an important subject, the subject of where the Bible came from. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for the preservation of your holy word down through the ages, that we may have it before us tonight, that we may open its pages, that we may read it, and that we may contemplate it and understand it, and that it may direct us in spiritual ways. We pray for your blessing upon all of us tonight, both listener and speaker, as we seek to understand the origins of your word, that we may have a stronger faith and understanding of how these things came to be, and that we may be able to give a firm answer to those who inquire of us about where thy word came from. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for this time now, and we seek your blessing through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Just to introduce our brother Peter's words tonight, we'll take a reading from Psalm 19. We'll ask brother James to come and read that for us. Thanks, James.
Reading together Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. Their voice goes out to all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned. In keeping them there is great reward. Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults. Keep back your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Thanks for that reading, James. I now invite your attention to Brother Peter, who will speak to us how the Bible came to us. Thanks, Peter.
Thank you, Mark, and good evening, everybody. Well, our subject tonight is a really important subject, as our chairman's indicated. This evening isn't just an evening designed to provide an improvement in general Bible knowledge or give some background to the Bible, just sort of out of interest. It's something that's very important because all of the beliefs that we as Christadelphians hold are based on the assumption that the Bible we are drawing them from is accurate in the first place. So it provides a foundation for everything that we believe and teach. And we want to be very confident in that foundation that we're starting with. And so that's what our subject is on to do tonight, to show firstly how the Bible came about in the very first instance when it was written in previous centuries, and then also how it got from that original point through to the copies in English that we've got on our laps this evening. So just before we get underway, a bit of quick background information about the form and content of the Bible, if it's something you haven't spent a lot of time looking at before, which will just help a little bit to understand some of our subsequent material. So if we just opened up the Bible for the first time, what would we find? Well, firstly, we'd discover that the Bible is different to most books because it actually consists of a collection of 66 smaller books rather than just being a traditional one single book like most that you would find today. Although there are 66 books, the message amongst them is still consistent. So these books are divided into various ways. Firstly, they're grouped into two testaments, the Old and New. The Old Testament consists of 39 of those 66 books and the New Testament 27. And then within those two testaments, the 66 books are grouped roughly in chronological order in our English Bibles, although in some cases they're grouped more by type rather than by chronology. And the books weren't all written at the same time like a typical book today would be, but rather they're actually written at over a long period of time, over 1,500 years, by a range of different authors, ranging from 1,500 BC to around about 100 AD, so 1,600 years to be slightly more accurate. And over 40 authors were involved in the writing of the book, with a whole range of backgrounds. People like David and Solomon, who were kings, people like Peter, who were fishermen, Luke, who was a doctor, Amos was a herdsman, Matthew was a tax collector. So there's a whole range of different professional backgrounds. But more importantly, much more importantly, in fact, is that really there was only one author behind all of these individuals, and that, of course, was God. And we'll discuss that more in a moment. And lastly, the Bible was not originally written in English, of course. It was written in the languages of those to whom it was originally given. The Old Testament was almost entirely written in Hebrew, the New Testament in Greek, and a very small amount of the Old Testament was written in another language called Aramaic, which is very similar to Hebrew, and in some references you'll see that referred to as Chaldee rather than Aramaic, such as in Strong's Concordance. And we'll have a look later at what some of those texts look like too. All right, so that just a very broad introduction to the Bible. We then are led to ask a few questions then about the Bible, which all sort of fall under that broad category of the title of our lecture, how the Bible came to us. So the first question we might ask ourselves is, how was it that each one of these original books came to be written? Each individual book was where did the ideas come from, and how were they physically recorded? Secondly, once you've got an individual book, and then a number of individual books, eventually you've got the full 66, they've got to be collected together or compiled into a Bible as a whole. And how did that happen? And then once that's happened, today, of course, we've got an English Bible in front of us over nearly 2,000 years later. How did that come to be produced? It relies obviously on copies of those old original manuscripts being made over the centuries. We want to look at that process. And finally, it needs to be translated because we're reading it in English and it was originally in those other languages we mentioned. So there's sort of four steps that we each want to consider it briefly this evening. So our overview of our topic then is as on the slide, how each book was written, then how the Bible was compiled, the books of it, then how it was transmitted, that's the copying, and finally how it was translated into English, before we have a little conclusion. So in a nutshell, you might say we're going from the divine inspiration at the start to the English translation that we've got at the end, all covering a period of over 3,500 years. So we've got a lot to get through. And just in case you're wondering, each of those individual topics are very detailed in themselves. You could actually spend a whole lecture talking about any one of those four topics. So if there's anything that you ask, you'd like to hear, and don't tonight, come and ask afterwards, because it's most likely just been omitted because we don't have as much time as otherwise we might. Okay, so let's get underway then with our first section, how each Bible came to be written. So we're just going to cover this one quite briefly because some of this material you may have seen at other presentations that we've done in the past. The 40 plus authors that wrote the Bible books, each in one of those individual books weren't books that the author just decided of his own accord to jot down out of interest, but rather it was, as 2 Timothy 3:16 describes it, God-breathed or inspired. So it originated from God. And there's some important things to make about, points to make about this verse that may not be immediately apparent. So the first one is, it's 1 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Now the word scripture is a Greek word that means something written. So it's specifically talking about the written word of God, and inspiration means God breathed. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. So it's God breathed. God breathed out the written Bible, and as a result, there's no scope for anybody to claim then that the Bible was only given originally as an oral message and that only a long time later it was written down, and that it was only the original oral message that was inspired and what's written down wasn't, because it says all scripture was written down. All scripture was inspired. And that word scripture means something written. But of course, we've just referred to the existence of human authors. So how did this God-breathing process work? And the other quote we've got there, 2 Peter 1, verse 20, which again you'll probably have seen in the past at lectures here, refers to the fact that holy men of God, men who believed and obeyed God, were influenced by the Holy Spirit, God's power. And that came upon them in order to allow them to write God's words down to produce the various inspired books of the Bible. So putting those two quotes together, we have the picture of God breathing out the scriptures and impelling holy men through his power, the Holy Spirit, to then write it down. Now, these two references, of course, are just blanket statements about the inspiration of the Bible as a whole. Are there statements in individual books that describe the inspiration process as they are created? Now, the answer is that in some cases there weren't. In some books, there's just no comments about the inspiration process and the book just gets underway without any reference, such as a lot of Paul's letters and the Gospels and some of the Old Testament historical books. But others, however, do make repeated references to the inspiration process in their creation, particularly the Old Testament prophets. So the cases we've got there are a couple of examples, Jeremiah 1 and Zechariah 1, where they'll say something like, and the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, and then what's been said is then recorded. So it explicitly says that this next section arose from inspiration of God. So sometimes it says that and sometimes it doesn't. Now, obviously this is a miraculous process, and so it's sort of not possible to go a lot past that level of detail in understanding the mechanics of how it works. But perhaps the only other couple of things we can say from looking at particular Bible books is that, firstly, often these inspiration processes were accompanied by visions or dreams. The book of Ezekiel is an excellent example of that, where the whole first chapter of Ezekiel depicts a vision that describes a vision that Ezekiel saw. And the other thing that we can observe just from reading these inspired books is that though they are inspired by God, nevertheless, the personality of the individual authors in the foreknowledge of God is still being retained in the writings. So if you read, say, writings by the Apostle John, they have a distinctive style, and all of them have that. And then if you read those from another author, say Luke, they're quite different in style, and they're consistently different. So God, of course, knowing the beginning from the end, is able to arrange the outcome such that he wishes it to be anyway. But it's interesting that that process still involves the God's use of the individual styles of the authors to achieve that. All right, so the outcome of all of this, and this is the most important practical point in this section, is that the Bible is therefore true. It's come from God. It's not just a human writing some ideas down. God is true, and the Lord Jesus Christ specifically makes this point about it. He says, "Thy word is truth," an immensely beneficial thing for each of us in our lives. To know that there is a source of absolute truth in the world that comes from a divine source, there could be nothing more valuable. And so knowing that the Bible is inspired is an essential conclusion to come to from tonight. And the Bible tells us that God wants us to know what truth is. There's a number of places such as those two we've listed there, Thessalonians and Timothy, where he specifically says that he wants us to learn truth from the word that he has written down. And that being the case, of course, we can make the very reasonable deduction that God would therefore preserve what he's written down such that people are able to access it and obtain that truth. It'll be no point for him to do that and then have it corrupted through the centuries such that there was no longer any truth available for those who read it to obtain. Now, at the time, the authors that wrote these books, the holy men as they're described, were able to demonstrate their divine credentials by doing things like making prophecies from God that only a divine knowledge in advance could have accurately foretold, or perform various miracles. And there's a couple of examples we've got there on the screen of occasions where that happened in the case of both the Old and the New Testament. Now, it's outside the scope of our lecture this evening to provide some evidence to support the claim that we're making from the Bible that the Bible is the Word of God. That's a really a whole other topic which we frequently cover at lectures from this venue. But there's plenty of examples of prophecies that we can even look at today, both being fulfilled in recent times and in the past, which demonstrate that these holy men that spoke from God could demonstrate that was the case by looking at the prophecies that they gave. So if you're interested in that, please speak to any of the Christadelphians, including myself, after the presentation, and we can go into that sort of thing in more detail. So that's the process of inspiration and the conclusions that flow from it. The other thing you might be wondering about is, how was the physical process of the writing done? You know, we know how we write today, or more commonly type these days, but how did they do it back then? What were the original copies of the Bible? What did they look like? So just briefly, in ancient times, depending on the location and the era exactly, there were various types of writing techniques used. They certainly, none of them looked like our printed Bibles today. They were generally written on materials such as papyrus, which is a dried material made from reeds, and then arranged in great big rolls and written in columns. Or another example is the material called parchment, which is made from dried animal skins. So often they are the two alternative methods or materials upon which things were written, and the mechanism for writing on them was generally some sort of pen made with a pointed reed, dipped in an ink made of charcoal, gum and water mixed together. So I've got a couple of examples. Here's a example of an Old Testament parchment. You can see how it's been sewn together and then rolled up and then written in the columns that I was referring to before. So this is an Old Testament scroll from about 100 BC. So that's a parchment example. This one here, which is a New Testament scroll from the early 200s AD, is written on papyrus. You can see it's a thinner material made of reeds, much more delicate. And then this is an example of an old ink pen. And the Bible actually refers a couple of times to this writing process. For instance, in 3 John, it talks about in verse 13 it being written with pen and ink. So that's an allusion to that type of writing instrument there. All right, so that covers our first section then. Hopefully you can understand the basic idea of how each individual book of the Bible was written, both its inspiration from God via the individual authors and then the mechanics of recording it on particular materials. So now we want to move on to the next question of, once we've got all the various books written over the centuries, what was the process used to then compile them into one single composite book called the Bible? And of the four topics, this is the one that we have the least information about from history, and even within the Bible itself. But we can certainly provide some information which is helpful and reassuring. So for most of the period when the Bible was written, it was during the existence of the nation of Israel, and as each book was written, it was then added to existing books, and they were stored at the place where the centre of worship was. So if you, that which is either the tabernacle or the temple. So if we just turn in our Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 31, we'll just have a look at an example of that. Deuteronomy 31, and we'll look at verses 24 to 26. And this isn't even referring to a complete book, but it's a part of a book. So Deuteronomy 31, verse 24 and 26, where Moses has made a number of addresses to the people and made them a promise, a covenant with them. And then he says, at the conclusion of that, it came to pass when Moses had made an end of writing the words of this law in a book. So there's the writing process that we referred to earlier. Writing the words of this law in a book until they were finished, that Moses commanded the Levites which bear the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, saying, take this book of the law and put it in the side of the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, that it may be there for a witness against thee. So it was written down, and then it was stored in the Ark, which was itself located in the tabernacle, which was the centre of worship at that time in Israel's history. And then subsequently it was replaced by the temple rather. So that's an example of how it happened in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, it's not as clear a situation, because by that stage, there wasn't just one nation and one location for them to be in. The New Testament books were originally sent to a whole range of different groups of believers that were individual groups scattered across the Roman Empire. So there wasn't one central place, and they were only collected together gradually over time. That eventually finished with the final book, the Book of Revelation, which was given in AD 96. And they were then collected together by Christians originally as a group of scrolls, and then as bookbinding technology and developed, it became collected together in what they called a codex, which emerged around the end of the times of the apostles. Now, the process of identifying which books to include, therefore, took place as each book was given. It was understood that it had come from a prophet and it was inspired and it was identified as such at the time. And then they were collected together using that knowledge. Now, how do we know, though, that the books that we have today are those right ones? And one of the issues is that there is no inspired contents page at the start of the Bible that tells us. The Bible itself doesn't have such a list, so we have to rely on the information of those to whom the books were given originally. And that idea is called, or that list is referred to as, in these days, the canon of Scripture. Quite an unusual term. The English word itself has changed in meaning over time. It's nothing to do with explosions or battles in this sense at all. It's derived originally from a Greek word, canon, starting with a K, which then came through the Latin and Old English to mean standard. And so as applied to this, it's a authorised or standardised list of Bible books. So if you sometimes read about the canon of Scripture, that's all it's meaning, the standard list of books that were considered inspired. Now, in the case of the Old Testament, the Jews have provided historical records which provide us with very high level of confidence about the books in the Old Testament that we have. One of their traditions was that Ezra compiled the Bible books together, although we don't have a list of that result. But what we do have is, for instance, some quotes from Josephus, and he said, for instance, in the first century AD, "We do not have 10,000 books among us, disagreeing and contradicting one another, but only 22, which contain the records of all time and are justly believed to be divine." And then he also says later that since the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, who was in the 5th century BC, no one has been so bold as either to add anything to them or take anything from them or to make any change in them. Now, if you're wondering why it mentions there 22 books and you remembered that there were 39 in the Old Testament, that's just because in the original way that the Jews collected their books together, they actually grouped them differently to our English Bible. So, for instance, the 12 minor prophets were all just considered one book by the Jews. And there's other ones that were combined too, like Jeremiah and Lamentations were one book, for instance. And so the 22 actually equates to the same 39 that we've got, just in case anybody's wondering about that. Now, there are, however, some other books of the Old Testament that you might sometimes see in some Bibles. They're referred to as the Apocrypha. But these are not, however, inspired by God. There's lots of evidence for that. They came after the rest of the Old Testament books are written, and none of them are, they were basically written between the Old Testament and the New Testament times. The Jews did not view them as inspired, and the Bible itself, as it says there in Romans 3, of course, the Jews were the ones that the Old Testament was committed to, so they should be the ones that would have known. But even within the Bible, we can see it's extremely unlikely that any of those books would be inspired. They're never quoted in the New Testament. Lots of the time, the Old Testament is quoted in the New Testament. And when you read the contents of the Apocrypha, frequently they're inconsistent with other parts of the Bible, sometimes quite absurd material. So it's only much later that there were some claims that these books were inspired, such as some Christians in the early centuries AD, and then the Roman Catholic Church declared them to be inspired not till 1546. So nearly 2,000 years after they're written, the church then declared that they were inspired. So the evidence for that sort of thing is all very late claims, nothing that relates back at the original time that they are written. So we can be quite comfortable that the Jews' testimony of the inspired books is accurate and is the same as the 39 we have in our Old Testament today. The New Testament is a little bit less clear originally. As I said, the circumstances surrounding the giving of the books was different because they were all the different groups were so widely dispersed, there wasn't just one central place for them to be collected. But even the earliest records we've got of books of the Bible in the New Testament all agree right through to the book of Philemon. But of course, the ecclesias in those days not only being widely separated, but also persecuted. So it might have taken a while for some ecclesias to hear about one of the other letters that were had been given elsewhere and to recognise, oh, that was a letter that came to Paul from, that was sent to this group of believers over here. And obviously in a time of poor communication, it might have taken a while to discover that letter existed and to hear that it was an inspired letter from Paul. But certainly the same process took place where the apostles and prophets in the New Testament could, like in the Old Testament, demonstrate that they were inspired by God through giving prophecies and signs, and therefore validate that they were in fact speaking under inspiration from God. And the Council of Hippo in 8393 was one example of a list which showed the full 27 books of the New Testament that we did today. But that was merely recording what had already been understood in the past. It wasn't a new decision that was only just reached then. And again, the doctrinal consistency of the books of the New Testament gives us confidence that they are inspired. So just to support that last comment about the council, here's a quote from F.F. Bruce from his book, The Books and the Parchments, where he says, "What is particularly important to note is that the New Testament canon was not demarcated by the arbitrary decree of any church council. When at last the Synod of Hippo in 18393 listed the 27 books of the New Testament, it did not confer upon them any authority which they did not already possess, but simply recorded their previously established canonicity." And similarly, there are some other books that were written in those early centuries AD that occasionally claims are made about as to whether they're meant to be part of the Bible. But like the Apocrypha, and often even more than the Apocrypha, their doctrines are so obviously inconsistent with the rest of the New Testament that they are clearly could not be part of the Bible. They teach things that are quite different, such as, for instance, explicit heaven going. So once you've got these books collected and we know what they are, a couple of other little details. Firstly, the name. So how do we get the name Bible? How was that decided? Well, it's actually not the word that the Bible itself uses to describe itself. Can you ever remember reading the word Bible in your Bible, apart from on the front cover? It's not in there. But it's actually referred to by other terms, like in our psalm this morning, this evening, we read about the law or the testimony or similar such terms. Or as we saw in 2 Timothy, it's the scriptures. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, something that's written down. The word Bible itself, which is perfectly fine to use, of course, where that came from is that Greek-speaking Christians came to refer to the whole collection of Old Testament and New Testament books together as the books, which sort of makes sense, the whole group of them. So they called them in Greek ta biblia, which is the Greek words for the books. And then over time, ta biblia just got changed into Latin, into a singular noun, and then anglicised into English as Bible. So we can all keep on calling the Bible, but that's actually where it came from, just a term for the books, which isn't actually the way the Bible refers to itself. The two testaments in the Bible, that's another interesting thing. Now, the word testament in Greek means covenant, and the idea of there being two groups does have a biblical basis, because in the Old Testament, God made a covenant with Israel contained in the law of Moses, and it was called the Old Covenant. And then when Christ came and introduced a new covenant, that was obviously a replacement for the Old Covenant. And since the Old Testament was written in a time that related to the Old Covenant, and the new relates to the work of Christ and beyond, it's sort of a meaningful thing to divide the scriptures into those two groups and give them those labels. But it's not actually completely clear that that was something that was done under inspiration. But whether it is or not doesn't really matter. It's certainly a useful idea to group the books in those sort of ways, because they have a sort of a subject correlation with them. And lastly, the order of the books in the Bible. Have you ever thought about that? It's not obviously particularly important. The contents of the books themselves are much more important than the order in which they're arranged in our Bible. And we don't actually really know if there was a divine order of books. It's interesting, just in passing though, to know that our Old Testament that we read today in English is actually the order of those books in our English translations derived from the Latin Vulgate, and it's not, and which was in turn derived from the Septuagint. And that order is actually different to the order of the books in the Hebrew Bible, which is the same up to 2 Kings, but then after 2 Kings groups the books more by type than by chronology. And as we said, it also combines, splits the books up differently to have 22 rather than 39. So that's just an interesting detail. The New Testament, however, seems to be have always been grouped the same way that we have ours today. Lastly, chapters and verses. Have you ever wondered about how they came about? Now, chapters and verses were not in the original Bible, just out of interest. If you said to the Apostle Paul you were reading Isaiah 53, verse 5, he would not know what you meant. He'd know Isaiah, but he wouldn't know what 53, verse 5 meant. They are, of course, still useful. The way the old manuscripts of the Bible were written was that the text was divided into paragraphs and separated by spaces called lacunas. But within each paragraph, there weren't verses or chapters. It was just a continuous flow of text with no spaces between the words and no punctuation. So quite different to English. And even worse, in Hebrew, there's no vowels, there's only consonants. In the original version at least, and it's written from right to left rather than left to right. So there's some very, very different looking writings if you were to be examining an original Hebrew manuscript relative to what we see in our English Bibles today. The chapters and verses were introduced by people in the centuries after the Bible was written, just obviously for convenience of reference. The system of verses can be traced back to the early centuries of the Christian era, and those that are in the Old Testament came from the Masoretes in about 900 AD. The division of chapters, however, is quite a lot later. It was probably first carried out by either, depending on which book you read, a Cardinal Hugh in 1244 or Bishop Stephen Langton in 1227, so they're both the same century, but exactly who did it first or who did it is a little uncertain. So I think that covers all the issues relating to the compilation of the Bible, both originally and as we receive it in our English Bibles to today. So we're now going to look then at, once the Bible was compiled in its original form, how then did it get handed down through the centuries to today? And can we be confident that what we've got today is what was originally written? So we need to take a little bit of information about this from outside of the Bible, obviously, because this has all happened since the Bible was written. And this is a really important point, because if what's written originally was inspired, but it then wasn't copied accurately through time, then we still won't have something that we can rely on today. So we still need to think carefully about whether this has been carried out reliably or not. And as we said earlier, it'd be extremely surprising if it wasn't, because God says in his word that he wants us to understand truth. And if he's let it been corrupted through the centuries such that it's no longer there, then it would be pointless. But it's still good to be able to demonstrate that independently rather than simply relying on that assumption. So, first point just to understand briefly is that for whatever reason, God did not choose to preserve the original copy of each book in a particular place. And so what we have today are not the original writing of each book, but rather copies of copies that have been made over time. And that has introduced a very small amount of errors into some of the copies over time, but not such that we can't, in most cases, identify them, and certainly not that we result in any errors that affect doctrine or practice in any way at all. So let's think about how we might establish the accuracy of the copies we do have if we don't actually have the original copies anymore. And there's probably four ways that you could use to get at least an indication of how accurate our copies are. So the first one is, how many copies are there? Obviously, the more there are, the better chance there is that an accurate one is amongst them, because we can compare lots of them, and if there's one that's obviously different and maybe it doesn't make sense, we can look at another one and go, oh, that says that, oh, that makes more sense, and we can weed out the error. Secondly, how old are the copies? Obviously, the older they are, the more reliable they're likely to be, because there'll be less copying. Thirdly, how much difference is there between the copies that we've got? If there isn't much difference, then it's probably been an accurate process over time. If there's a very wide divergence, then it suggests a less accurate copying process. And lastly, just looking outside the manuscripts themselves, what reputation did the copyists, the people that did the copying, have? Looking at historical sources for that. So let's quickly have a look at the Old Testament first, because the Old Testament was copied by Jews and the New Testament was copied by Christians in Greek. So, and there were two different groups of people involved, particularly in the early stages. So, firstly, Old Testament and the number of copies. Now, I haven't actually seen a reference that tells us exactly how many numbers of Old Testament manuscripts there are, but the oldest Hebrew manuscript we have is from the Dead Sea Scrolls, and there's 225 biblical rolls or fragments of those. There's certainly much more that belong to a later group called the Masoretic Text. And as a result, this summary's been given by F.F. Bruce again about the accuracy of the Old Testament. Even the Old Testament is astonishingly well attested as compared with Herodotus and Thucydides, and that it does not suffer even by comparison with Homer, who has been more fortunate in this respect than they have. So the number of copies is considerably more than other undisputed writers from that era. And just in passing, the number of Old Testament manuscripts is quite a lot less than New Testament ones, and that's because the Jews had a tradition of burying old manuscripts out of respect for God's word, and it had the name of God on it, and they didn't want it to be profaned by the material then being used improperly. So unlike the New Testament Christian scribes, the Jewish ones would bury the old ones, and so there's actually less of them around to look at than the New Testament ones. All right, Old Testament, the age of the copies. So the oldest copies of the Old Testament books we have today are the Dead Sea Scrolls, which range from 250 BC to 68 AD, which means that they are written anywhere from about 1250 to 250 years after the original books were written. So that means for the late books like Malachi, it's quite a small gap, because Malachi wasn't written too long before that period, but for the earlier books like Genesis, the gap is over 1,000 years. But this is actually still quite similar to other ancient non-biblical books whose accuracy is not doubted at all. So Tacitus, Herodotus, Aristotle, Sophocles all have gaps of about 1,000 to 1,400 years. So while the results of these first two criteria we've looked at are, you might say, acceptable, they're probably not overwhelmingly convincing. But when we look at the next two criteria, the case becomes a lot stronger. So let's have a look then, this is a picture of the Dead Sea Scrolls I've put in. Sorry, I forgot about that one. So this is an early example of a Dead Sea Scroll. This is the Isaiah Scroll from Cave 1 at Qumran. And the section is Isaiah 38 to 40. It's a leather scroll. And here's some of the territory in Qumran where those scrolls were discovered. Okay, now on to those last two criteria. Firstly, the difference between the copies. Now, the difference between the copies of the Old Testament is amazingly small, and that's what gives us the best confidence about the accuracy of those scrolls. So when you look at the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were nearly 1,000 years older than the manuscripts in Hebrew that we had at the, prior to the discovery of those scrolls, the Encyclopaedia Britannica says many of the scrolls are practically identical with the Masoretic text. So the Masoretic text, which was the old Hebrew that we had prior to the Dead Sea Scrolls that went back to about 900 AD, they were almost exactly the same as the Hebrew of the Dead Sea Scrolls that were then discovered in the 1900s, which were over 1,000 years older. So you've got this big 1,000-year gap, and yet the text hardly changed. So that gives us a very strong indication that the copying process was very accurate. And if we then look at the reputation of the copyists, we can see why that is. So here's a little description of the Hebrew scribes that made those copies. This is from Encyclopedia again. The Masoretic text that resulted from their work shows that every word and every letter was checked with care. When the final codification of each section was complete, the Masoretes not only counted and noted down the total number of verses, words, and letters in the text, but further indicated which verse, which word, and which letter marked the centre of the text. In this way, any future emendation could be detected. Experts have been astonished at the fidelity of the earliest printed version from the late 15th century AD to the earliest surviving codices, as in the original handwritten ones, from the late 9th century, which is obviously in comparison prior to the Dead Sea Scrolls. So the Hebrew copyists were just fanatically particular, and so we can therefore be very confident about the accuracy of how the Old Testament manuscripts were copied. Now, the New Testament ones, let's quickly move on to those. Go through those same four criteria. Firstly, the number. The number of Greek manuscripts is enormous. So over 24,000 Greek manuscripts of parts of the Bible, or the whole Bible in some cases, have arisen. 5,000 in Greek and 24,000 if you include the translations into other languages. Far, far more than any other ancient writing whose copies authenticity is not questioned. So just to give you an example, that graph just depicts it. So here's some other ancient Greek writers, and the copies of theirs that have survived is absolutely tiny compared to the New Testament. So that gives us a great deal of confidence immediately. The age of the oldest copies is also very close to the time of writing in the case of the Old Testament. We've got the Chester Beatty papyri and the Bodmer papyri, which are only within a century or two of when the New Testament was written. The John Rylands fragment, which is only just a few words, is actually dated, it's suggested, as early as 130 AD, just decades from when the book was written. Whereas often other books, not outside the Bible, are often 500 or more years after they're written. So just to give you an example, this is the fragment from 1st of John, the John Rylands fragment. That's John 18. And then on the right here, we've got an example of the Chester Beatty Papyrus of 2nd of Corinthians 1, which is from the early 3rd century. Then we've got the last two criteria of the difference between the copies and the reputation. Now, the Christian scribes, they weren't quite as good as the Hebrew ones, but they were still very, very good. There's different groups of manuscripts amongst those enormous numbers of thousands of them. Some are from different regions, some are older, some are newer. But the summary of those that have studied them is here on the screen. Compared with other ancient manuscripts, the text of the New Testament is dependable and consistent. Readers may be assured that the textual debate does not affect one in a thousand words in the Greek New Testament. Furthermore, no established doctrine is called into question by any doubts about the correct reading of this or that text. The Christian can approach his New Testament with confidence. So that's very reassuring to know that. And you can see the evidence from those manuscripts that allow us to reach that sort of conclusion. And having said that, that's been a very brief treatment of that subject, and we can provide more detail if you'd like. Finally, we want to look at how the Bible was translated. So it's in Hebrew and Greek. How does it come into English? Now, obviously, we want an English translation that most accurately reflects the message that God originally wrote in the languages of Greek and Hebrew. And the history of the Bible being written into English starts at least as far back as 700 AD. It's obviously quite sketchy, the detail that far back, but there are records of two particular translations of different sections of the Bible from that era. But it was in the 1300s that John Wycliffe first translated the whole Bible into English. That was the first time that we know of from history that that took place, although that occurred from not the original Hebrew and Greek, but from a Latin translation called the Vulgate. So this is John Wycliffe here, and this is an example of his original translation. So it's in English, but it didn't actually come from the original Greek or Hebrew. So there's still a little bit more of an improvement that could happen. Then in 1450, we had the printing press. So after that, we don't see too many written out like that by hand anymore. And William Tyndale then combined the use of the printing press with a translation from the original language of, in this case, the New Testament for the first time. And then later he also did some of the Old Testament as well from Hebrew, although he was put to death before, unfortunately, that happened. So there's William Tyndale, and you can see one of his early translations here, and you can see it's printed now rather than handwritten, and that's from the 1500s. This is a picture of Tyndale's Pentateuch, that is the first five books of the Old Testament, produced in 1530, and that's Genesis chapter 1. Then, of course, the next famous Bible we have is the one that we still often use today, the King James Bible, or Authorised Bible. King James I of England was the one that gave royal assent to having that translation made. It's a translation that a lot of care was shown in the production of. It was done with a lot of attention to be faithful to the original languages. It's recognised for its beauty and rhythm in its language, particularly if you're an English language sort of person. And consequently, it became really popular, and it was used very widely for a number of centuries after that time. And it's interesting in passing that a lot of expressions from the English King James Bible, rather, are still in everyday usage today. So, for instance, you might say, "Can a leopard change his spots?" or say, "Somebody arrived safe and sound." Or you say you're at your wit's end. All of these are phrases that are actually in the King James Bible and have found their way from there into everyday English. Even "fall flat on your face" or "suffering a fool gladly" is from the English Bible, the King James Bible. This is the next one that came along that was significant was the Revised Version. But that wasn't till the 1880s. So 250 years plus after, and in that time there'd been some new manuscript discoveries, languages of Greek and Hebrew had become better understood, and English had changed as well. And so the Revised Version tried to incorporate some of that additional knowledge, and that was reflected in those translations that you might see today, the 1881 and 1885 RVs, which included the Old and then the New Testament. Then in the 20th century, particularly after the Second World War, there was a huge outpouring of new translations. I'm not going to go through all of those, but there's just a table of examples ranging from ones like the Revised Standard Version in 1952, right down to the ESV in 2001 and the NET translation in 2006, although some of its betas did come out before that, but the first official publication was in 2006. So we've now got a whole range of choices of English translations, which then leads to the question of, well, which one might I choose to read, so that when I'm reading the Bible in English today, I'm still getting that original message that a prophet wrote down in Hebrew on a piece of papyrus and in a dusty Jewish locality in sometime in the BC era. Now, you've got to say that it's never possible to be absolutely perfect with translation because every language is a little bit different. And so there's always going to be just a slight loss, but not in any way that's significant, provided the translation is done well. So the key criteria, obviously, then is going to be accuracy. We want a copy of the Bible in English that is as accurate as possible conveying of the idea of what those inspired writers originally wrote in Greek or Hebrew. So the most important criteria then isn't going to be pulling out a Bible that just happens to seem the easiest to read, although of course that's handy. More, it's going to be the priority of accuracy. And very broadly, there's two types of translation styles which can just help us a little bit in our decisions. There's literal equivalence and dynamic equivalence, as it's called. So literal equivalence means the translation is done on a word-by-word basis as much as possible. So you take a specific word in Hebrew and you put a specific word in English that means that word as far as possible. So it's conveying the literal meaning of each word of the original language into English. And of course the advantage of this is that there's then less scope for bias from translators to appear in the final translation. But on the downside, the result can be a little bit more clunky and less readable because of differences in the way that the languages are constructed. The other option is the dynamic equivalence, as we said, the meaning for meaning translation. And the advantage of that is they're more readable because instead of going word by word, we're just going phrase by phrase and saying, well, the meaning of that overall is this, and this is what we're going to say in English that conveys the same meaning. But if you're doing that, of course, depending on what you think the meaning is, the result could be different to what the meaning actually originally was. So there's more scope for translators' biases to be introduced into the translation process. So you'll often get a more readable result, but you may, however, get one that's less accurate. So if we go back to this graph, this is a little summary of various translations in terms of their type of translation. So we've got literal on the left of the axis, dynamic on the right, and then on the left, the y-axis, we've got the type of English, whether it's Old English or more modern English. So you can see that some of the most literal translations are along here. The King James Version, Revised Version, New American Standard Bible, New King James, the English Standard Version, they're some of the more literal versions. And then the most dynamic ones, like the Living Bible, the Good News Bible, they're the most dynamic. And so when you read those sort of Bibles, the chances of the results being accurate is potentially quite a lot less. Whereas the ones on the far left are likely to be a lot more accurate, but they may in some cases be a bit harder to read. But because accuracy is our highest priority, then the conclusion that we should be looking at is that in preference, we'd be wanting to go for the more literal translation styles, or the Bibles that use the more literal translation styles. The others might be useful to refer to as well, but the most high priority should be given to the more literal styles, such as those that we've got there, the King James, New King James, ESV, etc. So, in conclusion, we can have confidence that the Bible we've got today is an accurate reflection of what was originally given. We've seen that it was originally inspired, which is an essential starting point, and then we've looked at how it's compiled from individual books into one big book, and then how it was copied over time, and finally how it's been translated. And hopefully you've been convinced by the evidence we've provided this evening that all of that has been done to a high degree of accuracy, which then allows us to read it with confidence, and that's the concluding appeal for every one of us here this evening, to then go ahead and read it. We've got to be confident, but once we are, we've then got to do something about it and read it, because God's provided it as our mechanism to be part of his amazing plan of salvation. As we read in our psalm reading this evening, The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. And in keeping of those words, there is great reward. Thanks very much.
On your behalf, I'd like to thank Peter for his words this evening. It's been a very interesting subject, isn't it, to consider the origins of the Bible that we read before us tonight. It's where it came from originally, who the authors were, what their individual styles were, but also to see that consistent message all the way through the Bible. And it's also very interesting to have a look at those external validations of the Bible, just to see that verify how accurate the Bible that we have today is, the Bibles that we read in front of us. So that's very, very encouraging to know that when we actually read these things from the Bible, that it is the inspired word of God, and we can have confidence in that. So thank you, Peter. Just by way of announcements, on Tuesday, the 20th of April at 7:30, in this hall we have seminars, and the seminars are on Bible prophecy. Also, it follows on very well from what we've considered tonight. Bible prophecy, there are many things written in the Word of God, and prophecy are one of those things that that has been foretold in God's Word, and they are continually being fulfilled in the world around us. Many things have been fulfilled, and there are some things yet to be fulfilled. So please come along to those seminars on Tuesday. It'd be very, very interesting subjects to consider. Further to that subject, our next lecture in this hall is on the 25th of April, God willing, and that is also on prophecy, particularly world wars and prophecy, and we'll hopefully see in that lecture how the recent world wars that we've had were foretold and how they feature in Scripture, which further serve to validate the truth of God's Word. We welcome anybody, any visitors here tonight, to please stay afterwards and share a hot drink with us, and also to discuss with Peter or anybody else here tonight anything that you would like to consider or discuss. So please, if you'll all rise, we'll close with a word of prayer and give thanks for supper. Great and almighty God in heaven, once more we come before thee, thankful for this time we have had to consider your word. And we are thankful, Heavenly Father, that we have been able to read from your word and to also to consider its origins, to consider how it was inspired by you, Heavenly Father, and how men of old were inspired by you to write down that word and to convey your message, that we as believers in this modern age may understand it, and that we may have confidence that it is your word and that it is to be relied upon. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the hope that is revealed therein. We know there is much in your word that foretells much that has happened in this world's history, and also much that is yet to come. And we pray that we may seek these things out and understand them in the way in which you have intended them to be understood. We thank you for this time, Heavenly Father, and we pray for your continued blessing as we go from this place. And we thank you now also for the refreshments, and we know everything that we receive comes from your hand. And we offer you our thanks and praise now, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord.